So let's resume our activities here. So Professor Luis Caffarelli is going to deliver his fifth talk of this mini course. By the way, the first courses are already online. You can watch and can download. It's a nice thing. Okay, Luis, please.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so let me start by rounding up then the regularity of the obstacle problem. That is, we have already all the ingredients. Just let's see what we saw. We saw that the free boundary has finite Hausdorff measure. Hn minus 1 measure. Let me point out that the set of singular points where the free boundary has like a cusp can have a strictly positive Hausdorff measure. In other words, you can, it's easy to construct an example where, okay, a simple example would be to take a solution that where the coincidence set is something like that. If you take a very smooth, all I'm talking about the C2 alpha or C infinity theory. If the right-hand side is constant, then it's harder to see what happens. But if you are willing to take C infinity right-hand side, then you can take C infinity function like this. You can make U equal to 0 inside these holes. And you can take, for instance, the square of the distance functions, which is going to be very smooth in a small neighborhood, right? And then, okay, here the zero set will be like a bunch of the set of the free boundary will have these segments, right? You can say, okay, this is a little bit cheating, but you can cheat better. And by adding very tiny zero infinity functions, you can make the singular set to be these end points. And you can choose a closed set with end interior and make it that way the set of singular free boundary points. So, and that can have positive measure. Okay, so there is not, you cannot prove like in other free boundaries problems that I will discuss later that every point is regular except for a set of Hausdorff measure zero. Here, you can have many singular points. So we show that. Okay, and then the things we show last time was that, let's say I will start with the solution U defined in the ball of radius 1 in B1. Remember, a solution meant that the origin was always a free boundary point. And then I want to discuss a criterion for when the free boundary is regular in a neighborhood of the origin, okay? So for that, we prove sort of a rate of convergence when you do dilations, a rate of convergence to global solutions, right? So we prove that, I'm going to look at U sub M, which is 1 over M squared M squared U of X over M, right? So this is defined in larger and larger balls. And then there is a function epsilon of m, right, such that um is always epsilon of m away from an infinite solution. in, let's say, the ball of radius 2. In other words, you take you have your U here, and you take this little point, and you you make a big dilation. So this becomes the ball of radius 1, and this has gone to infinity. And here, the solution is becoming convex. And so just by compactness, you can show that as you do these dilations, this gets closer and closer to a solution in all of a space just by compactness. Right? So suppose not. Then there is an epsilon and a subsequence of dilations and functions that are not converging to any infinite solution, but they converge locally to something, and that is an infinite solution. So we have that as we dilate, right, then this then the separation of this from a global solution, right, goes to zero. Okay, so this is one of the things we discussed last time. Four. Then five, we look at global solutions. Let me go here, five. So we look at the global solution U infinity. And if U infinity has empty, non-empty integer, the zero set, lambda infinity has non-empty interior, then the free boundary of U infinity at the boundary, at the free boundary of U infinity at the origin, right, is always regular because of this argument of the directional derivative being positive and like that. So it's regular. But it's with a regularity that depends of how thick is this set intersection the ball of radius 1, right, or 2. So we said, but it's regular, but, right, we look at the a minimum diameter intersection the ball of radius 1, right, the minimum diameter is proportional to the largest ball you can put in the set, right, the minimum diameter, let me call it minimum diameter. The minimum diameter is the following, right? You have the ball of radius 1, and you have this convex set with non-empty interior, and you ask what is the narrowest strip where you can put it, okay? So there is a strip always which is 1, right? And so the narrowest strip you call the minimum diameter. Let's call it tau, okay? And let me point out that if the minimum diameter of this convex set is tau, right, that implies that sort of this, that this cone contains the convex set outside of the set, outside of the ball of radius 1, right? Because if you have a convex set, right, and you take a line, for a while will be inside, but the moment it goes out, it always stays out of the convex set, okay? And if the convex set has minimum diameter tau, right, then any line that has a slope bigger than tau will have crossed the boundary of the convex set before you go out, okay? So minimum diameter in the ball of radius one of size tau implies that sort of in any dimension, right, implies that the set is contained in a strip like that, and therefore, when you go out of a ball of radius 1, it's sort of contained in this cone. Okay, so that means, so that means that there is some homogeneous flatness of the set, okay? And so one can, again, prove by compactness that if you have a global solution, infinity, with minimum diameter tau, right, as tau goes to zero, U infinity gets universally close to a quadratic polynomial, okay? So there exists a quadratic polynomial Q, right, such that U infinity minus Q, right, is a smaller or equal, let's say, in the ball of radius 1 always, in B1, right, is less or equal than some function sigma of tau itself that goes to zero with tau, okay? And again, it's by compactness. Suppose not, there is a sequence of solutions that do not are not close to quadratic polynomials, and that sequence has a subsequence that converges, and the limit will have a contact set with empty interior, and so it has to be a quadratic polynomial. Okay, so this is again just by compactness. And then we have finally this jump lemma, right? That says suppose that you have a solution, in our case will be the U infinity, right? Suppose you have a U infinity, right, with minimum diameter tau, right? And I want to use by approximation this U infinity to show regularity of the free boundary for an approximate solution, okay? And so the jump lemma said if U is very close to a solution, U bar, right, that has smooth level surfaces with the smooth, with flat, let's say small, with small Lipschitz, with small, with level surfaces of a small Lipschitz norm, then U itself has a smooth free boundary, right? Because you have your solution that has smooth level surface, quadratic growth for the function, linear growth on the derivative, and you have your nearby solution, right? And there was, since they are very close, there was this trick that allowed to jump and show that the derivative of the approximate solution also became positive, okay? But you needed the level surfaces of the nice solution to have small Lipschitz norm, which means that, so now we have, so it means that the U infinity to which U is close after renormalization has to have a non-trivial tau, okay? So basically, you have all of these parameters that depend one of the other, right? And the final conclusion then is the following theorem. Theorem. So let U be a solution in B1, okay, and let's look at the minimum, okay, to write this theorem, last observation, and the last observation is that the coincident sets of U and U infinity, when U is very close to U infinity, the coincident sets of U and U infinity differ in very little because of the non-degeneracy condition, okay, in other words, the if you take, so lemma, suppose that in B1, U infinity has minimum diameter, infinity smaller or equal than tau, and oh, let me first say in B1, okay, B1, suppose that U minus U infinity are less than epsilon, then the epsilon to the 1/2 neighborhood of the set where U is equal to 0 contains U the set where U in the interior of the set where U infinity is equal to 0. Okay? And this just is a little picture, right? You have the set where U infinity, the interior of the set where U infinity is equal to 0, right? So suppose that there is a point, right? Suppose that there is a point in lambda 0, U infinity, so here U infinity is 0, right? Then I have here the set where u is equal to 0. Then you have a set where u is equal to 0. So suppose that all of this set is contained, this set is not contained in the neighborhood. So there is a point in the free boundary of lambda 0, which is epsilon to the 1/2 away, where the point where u is 0. In all this region, u is 0. Then you take here the ball of radius epsilon, and the supremum of u infinity has to be like epsilon squared. And in this region, this will happen in the region where u is identically 0. Okay? So each set contains the other up to an epsilon coefficient. And so then, now let me state the final lemma, right? So the final lemma says the following. Suppose that u is a solution in B1, right? And the minimum diameter, so then there exists a critical modulus. Sigma of tau, okay, and so sigma of r, okay, and so I said I have u is in the ball of radius 1, and I look at the balls of radius r as they decrease, and I look at the minimum diameter of the set where u is 0. So let's say that for this ball is something like this, and for this ball is something like this, and so on. If that doesn't go to 0, then u is a regular point, because sooner or later it's going to hit the critical level for the infinite, for the global solution, the tau of the global solution. So the point has positive density, then the free boundary is regular. But in fact, there exists a decreasing modulus of convexity, right? Such that, so if u is always below this critical modulus, never reaches the point where you can apply the jump lemma, okay? But it is enough that at some radius, it's thick enough, right? So that you can apply the jump lemma and have that the solution is regular near the origin. So what the theorem says is that there exists this critical modulus sigma of r, sigma goes to 0, going to 0 with r, such that we have this dichotomy. Or the minimum diameter of u restricted to the ball of radius r is smaller or equal than r sigma of r for every r, in which case you can never apply the regularity lemma, okay? Or it is enough that for one value, or the other alternative is if the minimum diameter of lambda u goes above r sigma of r, r 0, sigma of 0, just for one r 0, then lambda of u is smooth, is a C1 alpha surface in a small multiple of R0 in the ball B delta R0 around the origin. Okay, because you cross the critical value and you can apply the jump lemma. Okay. So now I would like to see what happens at these points, the points where the minimum diameter of u, right, always remains, in other words, the ratio decays with respect to R as R goes to 0. Okay. So the structure of the set of singular points. So what I want to prove, okay, is the following. I want to prove that if you have a singular point, asymptotically, what I want to prove is that at a singular point, U converges asymptotically by, after rescaling, to a quadratic polynomial. In fact, I want to prove that the limit is unique. Right? Because it could be that as R goes to 0 at different scales, the solution is closer and closer to quadratic polynomials, but they rotate. Okay, so I want to prove that this is a unique, with some general universal modulus of continuity. And therefore, each singular point has a limiting quadratic polynomial, okay? And the quadratic polynomials, which are solutions of our problem, can have a zero set, which is a point, a line, a plane. So they have all dimensions up to n, n minus 1. Okay, so I want to prove that the points that have a zero set have as lambda infinity, that is lambda of Q, the limiting lambda, which is unique, of dimension k, all lie in a C1, locally lie inside the C1 surface. Locally R in a C1 surface. Right? So they are in a C1 surface and they may be degenerating, and as they degenerate, the limit can be of at the degeneration point will fall into the next, into the local known as C1. So a C1 manifold of dimension k. And they can have as limit the next manifold of dimension k minus 1. Okay, so can fall into the sort of in the limit when they degenerate, they can fall into the manifold of polynomials with one more degeneracy. Okay, because they are degenerating, so they fall into the next one. Okay, so a fall that can fall into the k plus 1. Manifold. Okay. So okay. To prove this, I need to prove a monotonicity formula, which is, I'm not going to prove it for this because it's not worthwhile to put the effort, but this. A formula I'm going to use strongly for the next example, which is the two-phase cavitational type problems. Okay. So the monotonicity formula I want to discuss has to do with two adjacent domains. Arshak mentioned it briefly the other day. You have two adjacent domains, and in each one of them you have, so you have two harmonic functions, right? U1 and U2, positive. And they both vanish at, let's say, in this common surface. It doesn't have to be, the geometry is more general. But let's say first that they vanish on this common surface, right? So U1 equal to U2 equal to 0 among this common surface. Okay? And basically all you need is they to have this joint support. Okay? But let's say this. Then, for instance, we discussed in the case when this surface is Lipschitz, right, that the harmonic functions are all comparable, right, at the boundary. In other words, the normal derivative is all the same. So let me think about these functions as being, for instance, the solution of the green functions with some pole somewhere else. So suppose I have the green function here, and I here have some pole, x1, right? And so I have these green functions, and they are vanishing over here, right? And they vanish over here. Then if you have the green function, right, the normal derivative of the green function gives you the Poisson kernel, is the or the harmonic measure of U1, okay? And so what I want to prove is that sort of there is that if the harmonic measure is large on one side, it's very small on the other, okay? In other words, I want to prove that there is some sort of control of each, you know, each side controls the other in terms of harmonic measure, okay? So basically what the monotonicity formula says is the following. So let me take here a point. Let me take here the ball of radius 1, let's say, okay? And so I'm going to look at maybe let me do first some computations in 2D or in about cones that will sort of guide us in what am I writing, okay? So let me first do, so in general, suppose I have two cones, this and the complement. So I have a cone, and as I discussed last time, if I give you a cone, there is a unique harmonic non-negative function, and it is homogeneous, okay? So that's the Fragman-Lindelof theorem. So if I give you an infinite cone, a Lipschitz infinite cone, right here there is a unique function U, which is harmonic, non-negative, U positive, okay? And it is homogeneous, so it's of the form R to the alpha G of theta, okay? And then if you write the Laplacian in polar coordinates, right, this is, so U R R plus N minus 1 U R plus the spherical Laplacian of theta over R, and this is over R squared, the spherical Laplacian of theta, okay? So if you have this form, then what you get here is alpha times alpha minus 1, right, times, well, we'll have R to the alpha minus 2 everywhere, so that will be a common factor. Right, here you have plus alpha times N minus 1, right, okay, G of theta. And here I have, well, the R square of the R, and here I have plus Laplacian of G of theta, where this is the spherical Laplacian, okay? So in other words, if you have a function, a harmonic function which is homogeneous of degree R, then the trace on the sphere is the first eigenfunction for the spherical Laplacian, and this is the eigenvalue. So the eigenvalue is alpha square plus alpha times N minus 2, okay? Where alpha is the homogeneity, okay? So let me record that formula here, right? Lambda that is eigenfunction, eigenvalue. Is equal to alpha squared plus alpha n minus 2. Okay. So one simple monotonicity formula that you know is the fact that the integral, if U is harmonic, the integral of gradient U squared, the average of gradient U squared, is subharmonic, is monotone. Because the function gradient of U squared is subharmonic, right? So its average is increasing. Okay. Now, so here, what I want is some sort of multiplicative relation. In other words, I want to look at this average in each side, and if you want to expect something monotone, you realize it has to be some multiplicative relation. So the quantity I'm going to look is, first, is the integral, the average, so I'm going to look at the integral of gradient U squared. So let me start with 2D. I'm going to look at the integral in the ball of radius r of gradient u squared over r squared. So that's the average of gradient u squared. 1 over r squared, the integral of u1 squared, vr of u2 squared. Okay? And I say, this is monotone in R, okay? And the idea is the following. So for that purpose, let's take the log and take the derivative. So I have derivative of this over this plus derivative of this over this minus derivative of r to the 4. Okay? And to prove the monotonicity, I have to can do it at every scale. So I'm going to prove that the derivative is positive for r equal to 1. Okay? So I don't have to carry the r. So the derivative of this is the integral on the sphere over the volume integral u squared for 1 plus the same formula for 2 minus 4. And I want to convince you that this is non-negative. Okay? So the idea is the following, right? The critical, the sort of critical configuration where these quantities are the least, right? These are, okay, what are these? So this is u r squared plus u theta squared. And here, gradient u squared is, since u is harmonic, is the Laplacian of u squared over 2. So this is r u r. So this is for the 1, right? 1, 1, 1. R u r, u u r, sorry. And this is for the 2. Minus 4. I don't want to erase this because I'm going to use it in the future. So now I'm going to do a computation which is exact for two linear functions. Okay? And I say that hopefully for any other configuration has to be worse because the two linear functions are the most organized. Monotonicity formulas are usually like entropy-like formulas, like when Arshak the other day discussed the Almgren's monotonicity formula, right? So let me make another. Almgren's monotonicity formula was the integral of gradient u square in the ball of radius r, normalized by r, the integral of u square on the boundary of the ball of radius r. Okay? But the integral of gradient u square for a harmonic function is equal to the h one half norm on the boundary. Right, is u u nu. So basically, this is the ratio between the h one half norm, right, on the boundary of BR over the L2 norm on the boundary of BR. So this is the Rayleigh quotient. Okay? And so what this says is for a harmonic function, if you start in the ball of radius 1 and goes to R1, towards 0, the Rayleigh quotient is decreasing. In other words, the function organizes itself. When you go to the origin, the function is a harmonic polynomial. And as you went away, this organizes itself. Okay? And so here, I think it should be the same, right? So here, we want to prove, here we have minus 4. So I'm going to make a computation which is exact for two planes. Okay? So for two planes in two dimensions, you are, so in two dimensions, for two planes, u r and u theta are the same because the solution is r cosine of theta, right, in 2D. And so the derivative in theta has the sine and the r cosine. So this and u are the same for two planes. Okay? So so here I'm going to say this. So I want to prove that this is bigger than 4. So I say this is bigger or equal than, on the denominator, I'm going to put the integral of u square 1 half, the integral of u r square 1 half. Right? And this is larger, so I'm decreasing the quantity. Okay? And here, I'm going to put the same. I'm going to put u r square 1 half, the integral of u theta square 1 half. So I'm decreasing the denominator, I'm increasing the numerator. So this quantity is bigger, this quantity is smaller than that one, right? So here I have the same, right, minus 4. So it's enough that I show that this is positive, okay? Now, this and this cancel, right? And I end up with the Rayleigh quotients, not one half, sorry. It's UR square 2 and 2, okay? It's without one half. So this and this cancels, and I end up with 2 times then u theta square over u square, that is the two Rayleigh quotients, this one and the one for the complementary angle. Let me call it u1 and u2. So basically, what I want to show is that if I take the unit circle and I decompose it in two sets, let's say, blue, and I look at the corresponding Rayleigh quotients, the sum is bigger than 2. For two planes, these are 1 and this is 1, the two Rayleigh quotients. So in that case, it's exact. 2 times 2 is 4. Okay? Now, the first observation is if I have this bunch of little pieces and I put them together in a set of the same measure, then the Rayleigh quotient will decrease. Right? Because Each one of these intervals will have a Rayleigh quotient bigger than just the bigger set. Okay? So this is going to be smaller or equal than the Rayleigh quotients that correspond. So for any two sets of measures, mu1 and mu2, this is going to be minimized when I put the two arcs. Okay? Now, for the two arcs, what are the Rayleigh quotients? So in two dimensions, the solutions are r to the alpha cosine alpha theta. Okay? And so I have the first one, alpha 2, and r alpha 2 cosine alpha 2 theta. Okay, and they are complementary arcs, right? So that means, what does it mean? Well, okay, this vanishes when alpha 1 theta is equal to pi over 2. Right, this is the first seat of the cosine, and this vanishes when alpha 2 theta is equal to pi over 2. So complementary is alpha 1 and alpha 2, right, satisfy that they vanish. Let's see. What am I saying? I have alpha 1. Okay, I have to satisfy that alpha 1, okay, this vanishes when theta 0, okay, when theta 0 is equal to pi over 2 alpha 1, and this vanishes when theta 1 is equal to pi over 2 alpha 2, right? And these have to be complementary. That is, this angle plus this angle has to add up to pi, right? Because it's this half and this half, okay? So this plus this has to add up to pi, so we cancel pi, and we have that 1 over 2 alpha 1 plus 1 over 2 alpha 2, right, has to be equal to 1. Okay? And what we want is to show that alpha 1 plus alpha 2, let's see, 2, because here is a 2 missing, right? This is, you want you 2, this is a 2 missing here, right? This is 2 times. So we want to show that 2, alpha 1 plus alpha 2, is bigger than 4. Okay? 2, alpha 1 plus alpha 2. But alpha 1 plus alpha 2 are the inverse of this. Okay? So that means that alpha, this, if we call this S1 and S2, alpha 1 is a convex function of alpha 2. It's 1 over S. Okay? So I have this convex function, and I want to minimize it, right, when the sum is equal to 1. By convexity, this is bigger than the eigenvalues, the 2 times the eigenvalues at 1. Okay? And the eigenvalues at 1, we are exact. We are the 1 and 1, okay? So remember the convexity, because this is going to come at the end. So now comes the n-dimensional case. Okay? And so if you try to do the same for the n-dimensional case, you immediately run into trouble, because the relation between homogeneity an eigenvalue, right? The relation between homogeneity and eigenvalue is not 1 and 1. Okay? In other words, the relation between homogeneity and eigenvalue is much more complex. Okay? So you have to change your monotonicity formula to account for this n minus 2. So the monotonicity formula to do is the following. So the n-dimensional monotonicity formula So I'm going to look at the integral of gradient u1 squared over x to the n minus 2, the fundamental solution, in the ball of radius r. And to make it an average, I want to divide by r squared. Okay, so this is like average dividing by r to the n. Right? I mean, this is little r to the n minus 2 and r squared outside. So I'm going to look at this quantity times this quantity. And I want to prove that this is a monotone function of r. So this is like an average. If you have, this is the homogeneity of the first derivative, right? In other words, if you have, if you are looking at functions in cones, then the function will have homogeneity alpha, and this will have alpha minus 1 squared, okay? And I want to pick up the two linear functions as the optimal, optimal decomposition, okay? So we do the derivative of that, right? So we have the integral. I'll do just one of them, gradient u squared. So again, I'm going to prove that the derivative is serious, that the function, that the derivative of the log is positive for r equal to 1, OK? So then I have in the boundary of b1, s1, I will have on the numerator, I will have the derivative of this. So it will be gradient u once gradient u squared. This is 1, and that's it, right? It's the derivative with respect to the radius, OK? And in the denominator, I will have the volume integral, which is gradient u squared over x to the n minus 2, the volume. And I want to make it a surface integral, OK? So this gradient u squared is Laplacian of u squared over 2. And since this is harmonic in the domain and has the pole where u vanishes, then I can subtract minus over 2 Laplacian of x to the minus n minus 2, right? And then by Green's formula, this is the integral of u nu in the sphere, well, this is 1 in the sphere 1, right? And this is plus, so I have to take u squared over 2, the derivative of this at x equal to r, which is negative, so I put the plus times n minus 2, okay? So basically, basically, I have to look at the integral of gradient u squared on the top. I'm going to write it as u nu squared. I'm going to write here u theta squared. But this u theta squared really is the gradient in the theta, in the sphere, right? Gradient u theta squared. And I have divided this by the integral of u nu. UUR, right, plus u squared over 2 n minus 2. N minus 2. Okay, so now I cannot split. Now, how do I have to split? So now I want to split, right? So first, okay, the first thing is this is always bigger or equal by definition that the first eigenvalue of the domain times u squared, okay? So I'm going to substitute this by lambda u squared. And now I want to put a piece of this u over here, right, to cancel, to compete with this part. And the rest has to compete with this part. And I want then the coefficients to be the same so I can cancel them, okay? So in other words, I want to split a lambda in lambda beta plus lambda 1 minus beta, okay? And so I put the lambda beta here. I put it here so I don't spend so much blackboard. So that means I have here the integral of u nu squared plus lambda beta u squared, right, plus lambda 1 minus beta u squared divided by u nu, integrals all over, plus u square n minus 2 over 2. Okay. So I want to change this by integral of u square 1 half. Integral of u nu square 1 half. Okay. And I want to change this by 2 times this to the 1 half times this to the 1 half. Okay. So just let me do it in another. So in the denominator, I want to do integral of u squared 1 half, integral of u nu squared 1 half, plus u squared n minus 2 over 2. Right? And here, I want to put A squared plus b squared is bigger or equal than 2ab, so I'm going to put 2, the integral of u nu squared 1 half, lambda beta to the 1 half, integral of u squared 1 half. So this factor is equal to this factor except for this number. Okay, and here I have plus lambda 1 minus beta u squared. Okay, and I want to be able to take this constant as a common factor. Okay, so I have to choose the partition. We have to choose the partition such that lambda beta 1 half 2 lambda beta 1 half divided by 1 equal to lambda 1 minus beta divided by n minus 2 over 2. So this and this cancels, right? And I get that lambda beta 1 half must satisfy, let's call this h, right? Then here we have this and this, so it's minus, so let me pass everything from this side, so I have that n minus 2 times h, which is when I pass this, and when I pass this, get h squared plus this equal to lambda. Fiat lux. This is exactly the relation for the homogeneity of the that correspond for the corresponding homogeneity. Okay? So that means that So that means that this is the homogeneity, right? So that means, what am I saying? Yeah, this is the lambda is the homogeneity. What am I saying? No, lambda. Square root of beta 1/2, where is it? Here it is. Square root of beta 1/2, right, is equal to this quotient and this quotient. I can replace them by the homogeneity, okay, alpha. So this is alpha, right? And I have chosen so that these two were the same. So this is alpha. So that means that this is the homogeneity alpha times. And now if I choose this as a common factor, the numerator and the denominator are the same. That's the way I choose the beta, okay? So that means that all of this quantity is exactly alpha, the homogeneity that corresponds to lambda, okay? So this was the homogeneity for the spherical harmonic for the cylinder. Now there is a theorem of Sperver that says that if you take in any dimension, two domains of measures mu 1 and mu 2, well, you take one domain of measure mu 1 and you look at the first eigenvalue of the domain, it is realized on the spherical cap. Okay? So that means that we can do the computation just for spherical caps. And for spherical caps, this is exactly the homogeneities, according to the formula, of those spherical caps. Okay? So in other words, to prove the monotonicity, we have reduced our problem to prove that if you decompose the Bode sphere of radius 1 into any two spherical caps, right, the sum of the homogeneities is bigger than 2, and is 1 for the half space. Okay? Okay. So to prove, you are given two spherical caps, of measures mu 1, mu 2, in the unit sphere of Rn, and you want to look at the homogeneities, look at the homogeneities, and you want to look at the sum of the homogeneities is bigger than 2.
Okay. Okay.
So the first observation is that you, if you increase the dimension, for the same volumes, the homogeneities decrease. Okay? Or the eigenvalues decrease. Why is that? Because because if you increase, so you can always extend if you increase the dimension, then you can always extend your function, making it constant in the new dimensions. In other words, you take your u and you make it constant. So basically, what you get, right, in every slice. What you get in every slice, right, is an homogeneous. So you get two domains which have exactly the same volume, the same ratio of volumes of surfaces. Because in every slice, the ratio between this domain and this domain remains the same, right? In other words, the volumes decrease, but the ratio between this area and this area is the same as this area and this area. So if you integrate, or this, I'm sorry, this area and this area, right? This with respect to this. So if you extend by constant, right, you get a new function that competes for the smallest homogeneity in a larger dimension. Okay? And therefore, the smallest homogeneity will be smaller or equal than this. Okay? So, or the Rayleigh quotient, the smaller Rayleigh quotient will be. So I'll work with Rayleigh quotients. I'm going to show that they are the same as homogeneities, okay, the quotient. So the same with the Rayleigh quotients. If you extend, then the Rayleigh quotients, this will compete for a Rayleigh quotient with what we a competing term for the Rayleigh quotient. And so the Rayleigh quotient will decrease, okay? So the Rayleigh quotients, so I'm going to look at Rayleigh quotients, and then I want to show that they converge to the same homogeneity, like homogeneity, right? The ratio for the homogeneities, right? So I'm going to look at Rayleigh quotients. And so for larger domain, so what is the Rayleigh quotients for a cap on the sphere? In Rn. So basically, the Rayleigh quotient for a cap of the sphere is the integral. So the Rayleigh quotient for the sphere is the integral, right, of what? Is the integral of u prime of theta. This now is theta, the angle in just in this direction, and then the function is constant in the slices, right? So because we are looking at the spherical cap, so it's constant in the slices. So it will be u prime of theta square, then times the area of this surface, right, which is, let me take cosine and sine. So here is theta, this is cosine theta, this is sine theta, right? So this area is like sine theta to the n minus 1 d theta. Right, divided by u of theta
square sine theta to the n minus 1 d theta. Okay? And so this is what I'm minimizing when I'm looking at the Rayleigh quotient in a spherical cap. So now let me make the change of variable, cosine theta equal x, right? So the x, the theta, right, is equal sine theta. And so if I want and u sub theta is equal to u sub x sine theta. Okay? So here I get u of x, u of theta, if I make the change of variable, it will be u of x, right? Sine theta to the n minus 1, but I have also to replace the d theta by the x, so I have an extra sine theta, so it's n minus u theta is ux sine theta, so I have an extra sine theta. Anyway, these numbers will not be important when I pass to the limit too much. So here I get square root of 1 minus x squared, because it's a sine, to the n, okay, dx. And here I have to take u prime, u sub theta is u sub x sine theta. So that means that I have to add 2 more sine theta. So here I will have the integral of u prime of x, that is the derivative with respect to x squared. And here I have square root of 1 minus x squared to the n plus 1 dx. Okay? So I want to look at what happens with these Rayleigh quotients dx when n goes to infinity. Okay. Now this is the Legendre polynomial's weight, and the Legendre polynomial's weight under rescaling converges to the Gaussian, to the Hermite polynomials. Okay. So we want to make the change of variables x equal y to the n. Y over n. This is the rescaling, so you are in the interval minus 1, 1, and when the dimension increases, you want to get the Gaussian rescaling. Okay? So then this becomes the integral of. So here I have, okay, I have here u prime of x squared, right? So x is derivative with respect to x, right? Is equal to derivative with respect to y times. So derivative with respect to y, with respect to x is derivative with respect to y. Y of x is y is equal to nx, to nx, right? So I get, what do I get? I get n squared or something like that, n squared. So square root, no, the eigenvalues, I give the eigenvalues. Square, okay, so I have square root of 1 minus x is y, so y over n square, right, to the n plus 1 over 2. Let me keep this there here for a minute. And here I have u prime of u of x square 1 minus y over n 2. So here I have dx. Dx is, okay, dx above and below are the same, right? So the term cancels when I do dy and dy. Okay, and then I have the ratio between the homogeneity and the lambda, which when n goes to infinity is like n, okay? So that means that this is the eigenfunction, right? But I'm interested in dividing by n squared because I want the lambda, okay? I want the homogeneity. So I divide by n squared, and that will converge to the homogeneity. In other words, when n goes to infinity, right, then this part becomes lower order, right? And then lambda, this part becomes lower order, right? And I want the homogeneity, which is lambda over n squared. So that means that the n squared that I get here from changing variables is absorbed by the fact that I want to look at the homogeneity, okay? So, okay, what is this when n goes to infinity? Well, okay, I'm missing a y to get the Gaussian, right? Here, I'm sorry, what I'm putting by square to the n minus 1 over 2. And I'm missing a y, again here, to get the Gaussian. Okay? So when n goes to infinity, when n goes to infinity, right, then square root 1 minus 1, I'm sorry, square root of n over 2. Yeah, n over 2, n over 2, right? So here I get this is in the Gaussian square. What do I want to do here? I'm sorry, I'm missing the y square to get the Gaussian. And here I'm, so here the change of variables n to the 1 half. Okay, so I make the change of variables n to the 1 half. So here I have n, okay? Mm-hmm. So I'm missing that change of variables. I'm changing that change of variables. And then this is e, 1 over e. And so I get the integral of u prime of y squared times e to the minus y squared over 2. Divided by u of y squared e to the minus y squared over 2. Okay? So basically, now this has become the question of the sum of the two complementary eigenvalues for the Gaussian. In other words, now I have the Gaussian. I have the Gaussian, right, in all of R. And I want to look at the eigenvalues, the first eigenvalue for the Gaussian, from S to infinity and S to minus infinity, okay? Which is the same on S to infinity and minus s to infinity, right? Okay. And so I want to prove that I know that for the linear case, the formula was exact, and therefore here both are one. Okay. And I would like to know if this is convex as at very beginning. And this is a very beautiful, very cute observation of Bill Begner. They did the observation, they never published it because it was too simple in some sense. The Begner, Koenig, and Pfeiffer, right? They use, there is a theorem of Brascam and Leib, right? That says that about, you know, convexity of eigenfunctions for operators with a potential convex potential. In other words, if you look at minus dxx of u plus v of u, look lambda u, right? Then if you take convex two convex sets and you make the convex combination, then, okay, but this is convex. In this case, you can say this is convex on the value s. Okay? In other words, if you, okay, and this is this is a theorem of Brascam and Leib, right? V times u, v, and they observe that if you make a change of variable v equal u e to the minus y squared over 4, right, and compute the equation for v, right, then v satisfies the minus dxx of v plus x squared minus 1. And this is an equation with a convex potential. And therefore, this function is a convex function of the eigenvalue. Therefore, 1, which is the eigenvalue here, is smaller or equal than 1 half of this plus this. Okay? And so that completes the proof that you have this monotonicity, that this formula is monotone. Okay. So now let me see. I mean, this formula really we discovered it looking at the two-phase free boundary problems, which I'm going to start discussing probably tomorrow. But it came a posteriori came handy here to classify the convex, the singular sets of the obstacle problem. Okay. So I want to classify. I want to show how you can show this way that the quadratic polynomial does not rotate, in some sense, does not change as you shrink into a point, okay? And the idea is the following. The idea is to look at the first derivatives, okay? And apply this monotonicity formula to the directional derivatives, okay? In other words, if you have a quadratic polynomial, right, something like this, this is a non-negative harmonic quadratic polynomial. So it will be something, let's say something like this, for instance. In the worst case, in the case when there's only one point, it is something like this, right? So let's look at the section, right, over here. Mm-hmm. So let's say that the surface for one of the polynomial is this one, and for this another one is this one, okay? They both satisfy Laplacian of u equal to 1. So it cannot be that one is contained in the other, right? In fact, after an affine transformation, if you want, you can make one a circle to just have an idea, and the other some ellipsoid like that, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, you can always choose a direction. So if you take a directional derivative of the polynomials that have this level surface, right, then they will be, let's say, negative on one side, and then will become positive, okay? In other words, will be, you take the directional derivative ue, will be negative here and positive here, right? For the q, will be exact for the quadratic polynomial. For the u, will be more or less, right? So, So if you take the directional derivative in this direction, it will be then we will have the, for the Q, we'll have the perfect two linear things, right? And we could apply the monotonicity formula that would be exact, OK? Now, if this ellipsoid is changing into this, right, there is a directional derivative that will increase. Some will decrease, some will increase, right? And the corresponding monotonicity formula will increase. For one choice of the derivative will increase. For another one will decrease. But the monotonicity formula says that cannot happen, right? It only can decrease. And so I want to convince you that that will force the shape of the approximating quadratic polynomials to converge to a definite one, OK? So the first observation is that, as I said, as you dilate, right, the solution U gets closer and closer to some quadratic polynomial. Okay? So I said, if U is very close to a quadratic polynomial, the monotonicity formula of U will be very close to the monotonicity formula of the quadratic polynomial. Okay? In the ball of radius, normalized to the ball of radius 1. Why is that? Well, the monotonicity formula, each term of the monotonicity formula will be gradient u squared, u e, right, this is a directional derivative, u squared over x to the n minus 2. And the quadratic polynomial will be some, you know, the quadratic polynomial is x transpose times m times x, so the gradient is something like 2xm. If I take the directional derivative, will be e, right? But then I take the gradient, so it will be m times e times the sum, so it will be a sum of mi times e, right? The e components when I multiply by the matrix, a square, OK? So these are harmonic, or let me put it as gradient. Gradient of m e, of x m e square. Let me write it like that, OK? So these are two harmonic functions, right? And they are very close and strictly positive, except in a very narrow region, right? So there is this region where this may vanish, and this then will be close to zero, where we cannot sell. But since this is very close to this, if we extract a very skinny strip, in the rest, they will be equal, and their gradients will be close. Okay? So as the width of this nobody's land strip decreases, because this is converging to the quadratic and the function, and you are closer and closer after scaling, as long as this decreases, this will be closer to this, OK? So we can say that the monotonicity formula, the monotonicity integral e of any derivative, dCe of u minus e of dE of the approximating polynomial Q, this goes to zero like some universal modulus of continuity once more, right? So if this is in the ball of radius rho, right, this is the monotonicity formula in rho, this will get, as we expand and renormalize, will get closer and closer by a universal modulus of continuity, okay? So to estimate, so this is decreasing. As rho goes to zero. Okay. Now suppose that we have two levels. Let's say we have level rho and level drawbar, okay? And we want to compare the energy for any directional derivative. This is decreasing. So we want to compare for the two levels. Okay, so I say E of rho bar of the E of u is smaller or equal than E rho of the E of u. Now, this E rho of the E of u, right, is sigma rho of rho, sigma of rho away from the E of q rho, the approximation of u at level rho. Rho, yeah. And this is less than sigma of rho, because it's sigma of r bar, right? Less than sigma of, is less, this differs from E rho of the E of q rho bar, right, in less than sigma r2, right? Sigma rho 2, okay? So that means that this cannot be bigger than this plus 2 sigma of r, right? Because this is decreasing and this differs by sigma of rho. So E rho of the E of q rho has to be smaller or equal than the rho bar, I'm sorry. Has to be smaller or equal than E rho of the E of q rho plus sigma of rho bar, which goes to zero with rho bar. Okay? But these are two harmonic matrices, are the matrices of two Laplacian equal to one matrices, okay? So the difference is a matrix of a harmonic polynomial. In other words, I can write the q at rho bar as q of rho plus n, where this is the matrix of a harmonic polynomial, and the sum of the eigenvalues is zero, okay? Because this is the matrix of the harmonic, the difference of this and this is the matrix of a harmonic polynomial. So this is a matrix of a harmonic polynomial. The largest and the smallest eigenvalues have opposite signs and are comparable. Okay? So I want to show that this matrix goes to zero with sigma of rho. If this matrix doesn't go to zero with sigma of rho, right? That means that here there is some eigenvalue, right, some direction, E bar, which is the smallest eigenvalue, and is not too small, right? So now I take this direction, right, as the direction for which the one I want to compute the monotonicity formula, right? And then this or the opposite, we'll see in a minute, right? And then, so we have the derivative. So the monotonicity formula for q, for quadratic polynomial, the quantity in the numerator is a constant, right? Because it's the two second derivatives of the quadratic polynomial. The first to make the E, and the second to make the gradient, okay? So this matrix is a constant, okay? And so the matrix is a the energy is a constant, right? And so the energy of q rho plus n in the direction E is q times E, so gradient of q times E minus gradient, so it will be q times E times, so let's take a system of coordinates where this is u1, so it will be q1j minus q1j minus nj squared. Okay? Because I integrate in x also and I get a constant. And so I have that q1j minus nj squared has to be has to be smaller or equal than Q bar than Q. So this is Q bar, this is the Q, that's the same Q as this one, right? Q 1j squared, okay? And so I always can choose an nj such that this has an opposite sign as this one. I always can choose a direction, and then this is a contradiction. And this is because the eigenvalue is of order one, right? Like if, okay? So if n is equal, if j, so I have here n, let me see, n1j, and here I have n1j. So I always can choose one in the all the directions where the derivative of the q is in that direction is much bigger than the derivative of the q11, and that's a contradiction. So the q's have to converge to a single matrix as n goes to zero. Whoops, just one more minute. The q are converging to this matrix, right? And the strip where they differ from that quadratic polynomial goes to zero. Okay? So the strips where they differ the quadratic polynomials is eventually the strip where the polynomial is close to zero. Okay? So if you take two nearby points, you have the strip where this polynomial is zero, and the strip where this polynomial is zero, and there is a compatibility condition in both. The two strips have to overlap. And so that shows that the polynomial here minus the polynomial here has to be very close, and the zero sets have to be very close. And so that's what puts them into a C1 manifold. Okay, let me stop here. Thank you very much, and I pass to something else.